This Bites, discussing Milwaukee's culinary and restaurant culture.
With Ann Christensen of Milwaukee Magazine and Tarik Moody of 88.9.
This Bites is brought to you by Society Insurance.
Hey, Ann, on this week's edition of This Bites, we're very excited to talk about the return of farmers markets. We're going to talk about a couple of farmers markets. Specifically, one at West Allis is doing something really special on June 13th. Then also, we're going to talk about a rosé dinner at Pizza Man, the new menu at Rice and Roll, and a brunch event and cheese tasting that's happening as well. We'll get into that. But we're going to kick it off with our first topic, West Allis Farmers Market. And they're doing something really special on June 13th. And what is that?
Well, every week there are multiple West Allis Farmers Markets because you know that is the market that is open on the weekends, and then it's open one of the days during the week as well. And it's an awesome market. I mean, everybody goes there. A lot of chefs go there because it has probably
a lot more variety than most.
Yeah, the best selection of produce. Well, on Wednesday the 13th at from 5:30 to 9, they're doing a maker's market. If you're familiar with that concept, it's as though you're bringing in a broader element of wares. So, for instance, there are going to be 50 Wisconsin artisans and craft food producers. So they expand what they're selling, okay, for this particular market. And so if you are going to be checking them out, and I would highly suggest that they're going to have live music, and you're going to be able to purchase prepared foods from Double B's Barbecue, which is in West Allis, Aggie's Bakery and Cake Shop, Corvina Wine Company, and West Stallion Brewing Company. Those are prepared foods. And if you want to pick up some, you know, great things to bring home, they have a really nice selection of vendors for that as well. They have Newski's Bacon, Cream City Caramels and Confections, Kettle Range Meat Company is going to be there with their selection of meats. Underground Meats, which is excellent.
From Madison,
they do these great artisan salamis and summer sausages. This is a weeknight.
Weeknight, okay.
Stone Creek Coffee is going to be there, Usinger's Sausage. So, I mean, you're going to be able to get a lot of sausage at this event. So,
it's a sausage fest.
So, yeah. So, I mean, it's definitely a place to come and hang out for a while because you could get some barbecue, a baked good, a glass of wine, beer, something like that, and then pick up some really great items.
I assume there's probably some entertainment, too, probably.
There's live music, yeah.
Okay, cool. And what time this begins?
This is 5:30 p.m. On Wednesday, June 13th.
Sounds great.
Nonprofit Radio Milwaukee is brought to you by you. A membership contribution is your personal commitment to music and to Milwaukee. Visit radiomilwaukee.org to check out our donor benefits and the thank you gifts you can get to show off your 88.9 pride.
Now we're back and we're about to talk about another farmers market that's kicking off. The West Town Farmers Market, which is located where in?
I think it's in Zeidler Park.
Zeidler Park.
Which is right by Grand Avenue Mall.
Yep.
And, you know, you may have done this. Have you made that walk over there at lunchtime on a Wednesday? Yeah, it's really quick if you're in the Third Ward or anywhere downtown. It's a great market to go during your lunch hour. And you're kind of... let the smell of kettle corn be your guide because you're going to smell that wonderful aroma of that salty, sweet type of thing going on there. But it seems like this year, I'm looking at the list of lunch vendors, and it's really grown from what it used to be a few years ago. They've got the falafel guys, so they're going to be that's a food truck as well.
That's guys that make falafels.
Guys that make falafels. I think they're ladies too. They do shawarma sandwiches, falafel sandwiches, eggplant sandwiches. Funky fresh spring rolls. They're going to be over there doing their healthy grilled spring rolls.
Because they actually have their temp space in Grand Avenue. Yeah, so it's later be moving to the Sherman.
Exactly.
Phoenix.
But so this is a really great fit for them because it's right next door. A place called Greek Street, which is doing gyros, chicken souvlaki, veggie gyros, Greek salad, things like that. Lopez Bakery. Which, if you've ever had their empanadas, they're really delicious. Good. They do baked... I mean, Mexican baked goods are a little different from... They're very large, cakey. They're not as sweet. Lopez also does loaded... We'll be doing loaded nachos for this event. and like I said, these stuffed empanadas, which some of them are sweet. You know, it's like apple. Exactly. Streets of Pizza, Oscar's on a Roll. Now, Oscar's on a Roll is the...
Is there room for this, for all these people?
It's amazing what the
because it's not that big of a park.
No, it's really not. I think it's probably, they're probably going to have to close off. I'm saying this. I don't know if they're going to close off some streets, but Oscar's on a roll is the food truck arm of that great
Oscar's hamburger
place. Yeah, hamburger place. Sushi Go is going to be over there. That's a great
famous sushi burritos.
Sushirito. Yep. The Frying Dutchman, which they do Liège style waffles. They do Bitterballen, which are those like deep fried meatballs. Mm. There's going to be Tudo Sabor Brazil doing Brazilian food.
Oh, there's like a world over in the park.
It's a veritable international festival here. The soup market. And this list goes on and on. I don't think we even have time to even, no, we really don't. It's just like a ridiculous assortment of deliciousness. So, but you can also go over there. And as the summer goes on, obviously the selection of produce is just going to grow, right? This is really early on now. And into flowers and honey and, you know, all kinds of things.
Okay. And that's the West Town Market. That happens.
It happens every Wednesday. Okay. And I think it's like something like 11 to 3, okay. Something along those lines. Great. We will have that information to link to.
Everybody loves rosé. Even I've been drinking rosé later, and I'm not ashamed of it.
You know,
I'm trying to try different things and open my world and palates to different things that I used to tease, I guess the term would be. There are a lot of rosé dinners happening. But Pizza Man is hosting a rosé dinner.
Yep.
When and what will they be serving along with these rosés?
Well, first of all, it's the East Side Pizza Man on Downer Avenue. And it's on June 19th from 7 to 9. That's a Tuesday night. And this is part of their rosé dinner series. And it's the second in a four-part series. So there's four courses they're going to be doing, each one paired with a different rosé. And in a previous segment, we talked about rosés and how much they can differ in terms of lightness, more full-bodied. If you like a really rich red wine, you can find that in a rosé. Some are sparkling, some are still. So the first course is a pan-seared scallop with saffron and peas, with pea shoots and bacon vinaigrette. Second course is a fried goat cheese salad paired with a Gris Blanc rosé of Grenache and Grenache Blanc. Sounds real. So that's more of a salad. So it's served over, the goat cheese is served over mixed greens. Next course is a duck leg confit served over wild rice with red cabbage and raisins.
Crackers with that?
With a rose syrup and poultry jus, and that's with a Grenache, a blend. A lot of rosés are blends, and this is one of Grenache, Cinsault, and Syrah, so it's a little heavier for that duck leg confit, which you would definitely need like a richer rosé. And then finally, the dessert is a creamy vanilla custard. With a crispy sugar top, berries, and fresh mint. And it's with a, kind of a light rosé of Chardonnay, Chenin Blanc, and Pinot Noir.
Okay. And when is this? June 19th?
Yeah, it's June 19th, 7 to 9. A great way to spend a Tuesday night.
And you can do reservations probably over their website.
Yes, okay. You absolutely can do that.
Cool. We'll, of course, post that link as well at radiomilwaukee.org/thisbites. Let's talk about, it's season. A lot of people do spring cleaning of houses. Restaurants do kind of spring cleaning of their menus. And Rice and Roll is one of them. They have a new menu.
Mm-hmm.
And Rice and Roll is located on the east side, right?
It's located on Farwell. Mm-hmm. Its primary focus, I think, is Japanese. They've got a sushi bar, but they also have some Thai food on the menu. But their whole thing... they're thinking right now about seasonal items, so they're bringing in more seasonal ingredients. They're also doing a lot more gluten-free, apparently, based on the feedback from customers. And also, actually doing, like, upping the quality of some of the ingredients. So, in other words, I think they've actually improved the quality of the crab meat they're using. Let's put it that way. So they're using real snow crab.
Ugh, love that.
Blue crab. Yeah. So
you can taste the difference in a sushi roll. The typical, a very American calf, when they use a real crab, you taste the difference and how it's different from the imitation crab sticks.
And I can tell you about a few new items that are on their menu. One is called Dancing on the Moon. They're kind of known for these creative
sushi rolls.
Yeah. Well, and this one is a sushi roll. It's snow crab, cucumber, avocado, octopus, topped with salmon, tuna, spicy miso mayo, nagi sauce, and fried onion. They are doing, and this is just a mix of things that they're doing here, a Thai peanut sauce served on a hot plate. That's kind of a vegetarian item, but you can get chicken or or pork with it. They're doing a crab meat fried rice, which is a jumbo lump crab with buttery garlic, green onion, pepper, and lime dressing so, on like, the side.
There's a in the South. There's a the oh my God, I'm so senile. But South Carolina, there's a group of African Americans or descendants Gullah, the Gullah cuisine, which is a kind of the lowlands of the South Carolina. There's a traditional dish called crab rice, which sounds very similar to that.
Oh,
dish.
Interesting.
Yeah. Huh. I made it once, and it's really, really good. You have to use really good crab.
Yeah.
You got to use blue crabs.
I would think.
So don't use cheap stuff if you want to make a dish like that. But go ahead.
They're also doing a honey roasted duck with a homemade sesame oil sauce that's on top of steamed bok choy and Chinese broccoli. A lot of vegetables that are featured in the on this new menu item. So a lot of the stuff sounds really, really good. And I think they're doing a lot more veggie sushi as well.
Is that again, do I see mango demand. Sticky rice? Is that
they've them? Got? Yes, I was going to mention these are some of their special items. Addition to these, some of these other things I mentioned, they're doing shashu pork buns, which is pork belly, a mixed salad, honey roasted peanut, and a sweet brown sauce inside a sweet bun or kind of a yeah. Friday and Saturday nights, they're doing salmon toro and otoro, which is sushi or sashimi. Mm. But a dessert item they have is mango sticky rice. So it's mango sticky rice, coconut milk, sesame,
sounds
and coconut so ice cream. Yeah.
Sounds really good.
So that's one of their, yeah, one of their special
And that menu
items.
Is available now?
Yes.
Cool. And that's at Rice and Roll. Finally, we're going to get into one of your favorite topics. Do you know early this week was National Cheese Day?
Of course I knew that.
Did you celebrate? How did you celebrate?
I just ate cheese for every course of the day, every meal of the day. Every meal of the day was cheese.
No way. That's an old pun. I'm sorry. I can't think of any other puns. Mm-hmm. With cheese. I'm tapped out on cheese puns. But this weekend.
I was blowing my dairy air. I don't know where that's just a sad pun.
Yeah, that sounded like some South Park pun there.
Yeah. I watch a lot of South Park, so but I'm inspired. You
brought up an interesting thing that's happening. Is it happening this weekend?
Yeah, okay, so.
It's a cheese tasting and brunch at LeClaire Cheese Farm.
Yeah.
So, what are you going to do there? Besides, what kind of brunch is going to be served there?
Right.
What's going on there?
Okay, this whole thing is sponsored by the Village Cheese Shop, which is a great little cheese store in Wauwatosa. And they're doing this special event on Sunday, June 10th from 10 to 1. And they're getting people to drive out to LeClaire Farms, which is 1 hour away from Tosa in Malone, Wisconsin, for a creamery tour. So you're going to visit the make room where they're actually making the cheese, the aging caves. You're going to visit the animals because they make a lot of cheese from goat cheese. So you'll visit the goats and learn how the cheese is made. Then you're going to do a tasting of a lineup of LeClaire's cheese. If you know LeClaire Farms, they're known for their award-winning Evelyn cheese.
And that's
which is
that kind of a goat.
It's a hard goat milk, okay. Goat's milk cheese that has a really smooth, balanced flavor, not overly tangy or funky tasting, which is, I think, the knock that goat cheese has sometimes. Yep.
That's one reason I didn't like it. And lately, the last few times I've had goat cheese has been really pleasant. But like the first few times I had it, it was just like, yeah, take this off. This is too tangy, funky, kind of weird for me. But now it's been enjoyable.
So. Okay. You're making strides, Tarik. I'm glad to hear it. And then finally, you will have a brunch at the farms, and it's going to be a smorgasbord-style brunch at their cafe that includes eggs, ham, sausages, cheesy potatoes, yogurt, cheese. And they make their own yogurt, by the way, so I'm sure it's going to be good. Their actual cheeses and dessert. So that is, to me, like a great summer event to
do. What day is that on?
It's Sunday, June 10th, and I would say get on the website for Village Cheese Shop.
And where are they located?
Because they only have a few spots left. LeClaire Farm is in Malone, Wisconsin. It's about an hour from Tosa.
Okay. Cool. Before I go, I just want to, like, last week I was in L.A., Los Angeles, and I just want to go over.
You just want to name drop a little bit, Tarik?
Yeah, you know, I was hanging out with celebrities. I was doing something with Capitol Records, but I want to talk about, like, I went on a little kind of food journey. I assume you've been to L.A. a few times.
I have been to
L.A. I went to the legendary Pink's Hot Dogs. I've been around since 1939.
Tell me about that hot dog, because I like
there
hot
are different
dogs,
types of hot dogs. They're grilled kind of hot dogs, like I don't know if it's good. The one I had.
Are they grilled and ripped?
Yeah.
Okay.
They're kind of like, some of them ripped, some are not. They're all like, they all have different styles. There's LA, there's Chicago. There's all some name after actors. I can't think of the names of right now. But I had the 12-inch jalapeno dog, which included mustard, onions, chili, and bacon. Like, most people add bacon. It's like chopped up bacon, right? No. These guys add like 6 strips of bacon to my hot dog, which I thought it was going to be a skinny 12-inch hot dog, like maybe a 1/2 inch in diameter. That thing was like 1.5 inches in diameter, along with it being 12 inches.
So are you saying it had diced chili peppers or it had chili? Like
jalapeno inside the hot dog. It was like
chili.
Pickle.
Oh, okay. That way. All
right. They also had chili on top. Like chili.
I was thinking you
meant.
And
then the actual jalapeno dog actually had, I think it had kind of that pickled jalapeno, like you get a can flavor. So it wasn't very spicy, but you had that jalapeno flavor.
Did you finish this?
I finished almost everything but like 1 inch left.
You'd think at that point, why not just...
I just felt if I did that inch, then I would be in a lot of trouble. I just like, you know what? This inch just looks like a bad luck if I did this.
Was it satisfying? Did you like it?
Was it good.
Worth it?
Yeah. The chili was really good, I have to say.
Uh-huh.
But there's all types of dogs. It was a cool place. Really lovely service, actually. It had a little patio outside. Then I went to Park's Barbecue, Korea. I went to K-Town. I passed by. I remember I saw the Anthony Bourdain when he was in Koreatown. He was hanging out at the Sizzler. I passed by that Sizzler because I haven't seen a Sizzler since I was a kid. You know, Sizzler has people have fond or not so fond memories of Sizzlers growing up. I had fond memories of Sizzlers when I was growing up because then like, oh, you can eat shrimp and all that kind of stuff. But I know people up here, I've seen in my feed that people did not have good experiences when Sizzler was here in Wisconsin. But I'm not going to go there. But I don't
remember them being good. Like, I don't remember anybody reporting back with anything.
They were good
when
I was a kid, I guess.
Were they? Okay.
I mean, I was a kid, so.
Did you have Ponderosa, too?
I don't think Ponderosa was down south.
Okay.
We had Sizzlers down south. But I went to Park's Barbecue, and this place has gotten, like, huge reviews for their Korean barbecue. Not only did they just do traditional barbecue, but they do some really amazing kind of Wagyu, kind of real marbled barbecue, which I was going to get, you know, but I didn't want to expense that on my budget there for 88.9, the trip I was doing. So I got the little lower grade meats, but I really wanted to. It was really pricey, but it was really, really good. And I had some soju. The another place I went is, you know, Danny Trejo, the guy that plays, the actor plays Machete. Went to his taco place.
He plays Machete?
No, the movie.
He's in Machete.
Machete, yeah.
Oh, no, I'm not familiar with him, no.
Danny Trejo, but he has his own taco place and donut place and all these places in California. So I went there. The tacos are pretty good. People said, you shouldn't want a taco truck. But like, well, yeah, I could have gone to taco truck, but I want to go to see Danny Trejo's taco thing. It's like, you know, I've been to L.A. taco trucks.
Okay, let me ask you this, because the few times I've been to L.A., I mean, it's a huge city. It takes forever to get around. But I mean, you could just, I don't know how you could do more than make a tiny little dent. Like, you can't even do that when you go for a short, like a weekend.
Oh, I made an effort.
Right. Okay. So what did you do ahead of time? Did you do a lot of planning to figure out which places you were going to go? No. How did you figure out where you were going to go?
I just remember certain things that I wanted to do. I know I want to go to K-Town. So that was the first thing. I need to go to K-Town because I miss good Korean barbecue. Mm-hmm. And then other than that, it was just stuff that popped in my head that I saw on TV or I read in my feed or people recommended. I just said, okay, let's look at the time. Okay, it takes about 1 hour to get to this town. Maybe I go somewhere else. Because I didn't rent a car.
How did you get around that?
Uber. Because I was looking at the cost. Like, would it be cheaper to rent a car? But then I have to pay for the rent the car and the parking at the hotel and maybe street parking if it was necessary. So I thought that would be cheaper to get the Uber. So I think Uber was a little bit cheaper than the whole package.
Was Uber pretty reliable out there?
Yeah, it was super reliable. The people, LA, people make fun of LA saying people are mean and fake. I assume there's fake people, but people were so generous and smiling to me. Women who probably should never smile at me were smiling at me. You know, I'm just saying it was
weird. Why shouldn't they smile at you, too?
You know, I'm just small and, you know.
Come on.
I'm not like a stunning... I'm on radio for a reason. Let's put it that way. Also, I went to Danny Trejo. I had the chicken tikka masala tacos. That was really good. I had the steak tacos. It was also good. Blackened salmon, that was okay at that place. It didn't really have the blackened flavor. I mean, so I was impressed with that taco, but the tiki masala and the steak ones, the carne asada was really good. Where else did I go? We had this place, pizza place, that was decent. I had a kale pizza. Pizza with kale and spinach, which was tasty.
What else was on it? I mean, there were other...
Well, there's the white sauce. There was some roasted garlic, that kind of thing. Also went to a geek bar called Scum and Villainy, and it was cantina. It looked like the Star Wars cantina inside. And apparently, I don't know if you know Kevin Smith.
Nerd, from Clerks?
Clerks. He does his podcast in that same bar.
No. Did you see him?
No, he wasn't there.
Okay.
Where else did I go? Oh, Pink Taco was a place. Taco place. I went to the place. I had fried lobster taco. It was good. Just to let you know, Pink. If you go to Pink Taco, be aware. It's kind of like a little classier, but it's like Hooters for tacos. Just leaving it out there. Leave your imagination. What if you've ever been to Hooters? I know you've done reviews of different Hooters.
Uh-huh. Sure.
But that was good. Then I hang out in Sunset Strip. Went around looking for the perfect dive bar. Best dive bar in L.A. I've been to is called the Frolic Room. And you can get PBRs for the same price you get PBRs in Milwaukee in L.A. This is on the Hollywood Boulevard side. The it's a great dive bar. You walk in and you're like, oh, this is Milwaukee.
Right.
Because most bars, just cheap beers weren't cheap.
Yeah.
But there it was cheap.
Okay.
Which was kind of cool. I want to explore more of Santa Monica. I went to a place in Santa Monica that was kind of decent. Santa Monica's beautiful. But yeah, like I was thinking about doing like if the station or somebody or your editor wants to send us to LA for a week. Because you know that critic that did the documentary about, what's his name, Jonathan Gold. I want to do a week of just following Jonathan Gold's reviews.
Oh, yeah.
I think that'd be a cool project. Like, just go on his reviews and go to those places.
City of Gold is the name of that documentary.
There was a Thai place called Night Market that was supposed to be Roma recommended. I want to go to. I walked past it, but I was so full from Pink Taco. And I was like, dude, there it is. Should I do it? I don't know. But it looks good.
Mm-hmm.
Really good Thai food in there. LA is a interesting town. Oh, I don't know if I should mention it, but it doesn't matter. The magazine Hustler, they have a store. I'm not going to get to the store part, but they serve coffee and fresh squeezed juice in the store.
Just free?
No, you buy it. There's like a juice
bar. Oh, there's a juice bar.
Yeah,
oh,
coffee.
Okay.
The Hustler store, what you think would a Hustler store say.
Well, they want you to linger in there.
Yeah. I just found that weird when I saw coffee and juice on top.
So what were you doing in there, Tarik?
I didn't go in. I was walking. It was on a Hollywood Strip, a Sunset Strip.
Sunset Strip, yeah.
And then I went to a place called Boot Star. I was looking at, you don't think of me as the cowboy boots, but always wanted a pair. And I was went in there. I was like, dude, there's some cool stuff in there. And they had these shirts that I really wanted, but it was like all of it cost more than one month's rent. So I like walked out. The one thing I did not like at Scum and Villainy, because I don't think they're going to hear it anyway, they had different themed cocktails. They had a Wakanda, like Black Panther.
Uh-huh.
They had a Wakanda whiskey, which features a South African whiskey called Bane whiskey. Worst cocktail ever.
Really?
Oh, my God. It was just bad. I had to drink it because it was pricey. And I was like, I kept drinking it. It was like, had muddled or half muddled blackberry. So it wasn't very mixed well or whatever. It just was not a good cocktail. Like, why would you put this in the menu without, did you try this before you serve this?
That bad, huh?
It was, I never had a cocktail that bad. Sorry. The venue was cool. The smoke, everything was cool. But that one cocktail, because I didn't have any other cocktails after because I didn't want to spend any more money there.
Disappointing, Tarik. That's the one drink that you had.
Yeah,
there
I was like, I got the Wakanda whiskey, and I'm just like, oh, it tastes like you put vibranium in it or something. But
do you think the whiskey itself was bad?
I think the whiskey's good because Rumpus Room serves the whiskey.
Oh, okay.
I think it's just
what they did to it, like the muddled.
The mixture, the balance.
What a disappointment.
It was not what I thought it would be. But L.A., I think that'd be a fun trip for both of us to do a journey of Jonathan Gold's reviews for a week. And then, you can write it for your Milwaukee magazine, and we can talk about it on a podcast, and both operations can pay for us to do that.
You know, Tarik, you've got a lot of great ideas. You have a lot of ideas.
Yeah.
I don't know where that's going to go.
Well,
but I'm glad that you're putting
you just
it
gotta
out
ask.
There.
You never know.
I'm glad you're putting it out in the universe because you never know.
Yeah. Say, hey, we're doing a Jonathan Gold trek. And doing a story about it. And see how accurate Jonathan Gold really is.
Yeah, we're just doing like a background, kind of like a background check sort of thing.
Make sure he really is good as he say he is as a reviewer for the LA Times. But yeah, that's my LA trip. So I want to go back. It's great food. I love palm trees. Palm trees is the perfect antidepressant.
Yeah. You just love the way they look.
You just look up and like you're having a bad day and you look up, oh, it's all right. That's how I felt every time I looked at a palm tree. I was like, oh,
maybe
palm
you could tree. Get a palm plant.
I was looking at Google for a palm house. Like, is there a palm tree
that you could have
that's
like
easy to manage in a house?
In your house, maybe.
Yeah, I was looking for that, you know, like buy four or five of them and just and have in my
and
house.
There you go. That could be your antidepressant right there.
But I also think the blue skies with no clouds also helped. And yeah, it's great. I also hung out at Capitol Records Studios, but that's not really a food thing.
No.
But, yeah, it was cool.
All right. Sounds all in all like a great trip, Tarik.
Yeah. Maybe we can talk about your next trip. Where you go?
Yeah, I don't know right now. Mm.
Well, that concludes this edition of This Bites. This Bites is produced by Tyrone Miller. Handcrafted sonic inspiration comes from the License Lab with support from Society Insurance and your membership. Subscribe to this podcast at RadioMilwaukee.org, on iTunes, or anywhere you listen to podcasts. And always, as always, Anne, stay hungry.
And keep the Malord cold.
Yeah.